Hey everyone, thank you for joining us today for worship. I have just a few quick announcements to give you today. First, at noon every Wednesday, Robert is hosting a prayer meeting on Zoom. You can find a link for that on the Facebook page. And after every live stream service on Sundays, you can join us for fellowship time also on Zoom. Find a link sent by Sue for that information. And also, don't forget to be praying for your leaders. Robert, myself, and all of our elders need your prayers. This is a really difficult time for us, and we're still trying to figure things out, find ways to stay connected, serve our community, and be a light of the gospel in this time. So please be in prayer for all your leaders in this church. But also, don't forget to be praying for your brothers and sisters in Christ that are also part of Rose Valley Friends Church. And last but not least, we are just like everybody else. Our church is, so we're struggling just like everybody else. So please don't forget to give your financial gifts. There are a few ways you can do that. One, you can mail a check in to 1437 Rose Valley Road, or you could visit our website. There's a link at the bottom that says donate. That'll take you to a PayPal page where you can make either a one-time donation or set up a recurring payment. You could also drop off your gift Monday through Thursday mornings from 8:30 till 12:30. There will be somebody in the office to receive your gifts. Thank you. Hi everyone, and welcome to worship. We're outside again, and we've left our backyard and have come to the Reisner's backyard. Yes, they do know we're here. The reason we are here is because they have a beautiful creek running through the back of their property. And water, streams of water, is the image that we're working with today. In Genesis, there are streams that flow out of the garden and bringing the abundant life of Eden out into the wilderness, bringing life and quenching thirst. And in John 7, Jesus says he is a source of life. He says, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." This same water, life-giving water, is also the image that we get for Jesus' blood, which brings life and symbolically cleanses us from our sin. So let's sing, "Are You Washed in the Blood?"
To Jesus for the cleansing power. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you moments in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the man? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
This next song is called Kyrie Eleison, which is Latin for "Lord have mercy."
Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy. Our cry and heal our land. Beloved kindness, lead us to repentance. Bring us back again. For your name is great and your heart is grace. Kyrie Eleison, over all you reign, you alone can save. Kyrie Eleison, Lord have mercy. Christ have mercy on us now.
Lectio Divina is Latin for sacred reading. It's an ancient way of engaging scripture, a practice traced all the way back to the 3rd century. In this practice, you take a break from intellectually dissecting scripture or just passively reading it, and instead let the scriptures read you, allowing it to sink in and take root. To allow yourself to live into it through your imagination, soak in it, and digesting it slowly. Lectio Divina typically takes roughly 30 to 40 minutes, but today we're going to do an abbreviated version, just a few minutes. I will read a passage, Matthew 11, 28 through 30, and I invite you to close your eyes and listen with your heart open. Get comfortable, but don't fall asleep. I will read it once, then after a few moments of reflection, I will read it again. Then, after a few more moments, I'll read it again. Each time, focus and ruminate on a word or phrase that sticks out to you. Ask God why it sticks out, and ask what God is trying to say to you, and allow it to restore your soul. Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light.
out of the dust. You make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of us. Out of the dust, you make beautiful things. You make beautiful things out of us.
Psalm 23, 1 through 3 says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul." If you've ever raised sheep, and I have not, so this is what I hear, then you would know that sheep, they don't lay down in green pastures, they eat green pastures. They don't walk beside waters, they drink it. But in Psalm 23, the image that we get is of a sheep that is so satisfied and that he happily passes them up. David is saying that real contentment is not found in the gifts the shepherd gives. Rather, it is in the presence of the shepherd. This is something that I need to remember regularly. Not to dismiss all the good stuff that God has given me and given you, but I too often look to stuff as the source of my contentment and my happiness. And I forget that there's so much greater joy to be found in Christ himself. When I learn to train my soul to find satisfaction in God alone, then the gift is not nearly important to me as the giver, and the grass is not nearly as beautiful as the shepherd.
The King of Love, my shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. I nothing lack if I am his. Mine forever, and he is mine forever. Where streams of living water flow, my ransomed soul he leadeth, and where the verdant pastures grow, with food celestial feedeth.
Beside me, thy rod and staff, my comfort still, thy cross before to guide me.
day I sing your praise. Within your house forever. Within your house forever.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this week's worship experience at Rose Valley Friends Church. Before we begin with this morning's message, I just want to take an opportunity to say thank you to everyone who participated in my online Facebook church group poll. I asked you what are some of the things that bring life and what are some of the things that drain life. We have some great responses this week, and so for everyone that participated, watch your mail. You'll be getting a Red Leaf coffee card sometime this week from me. I appreciate it. Thank you for taking the extra time to do that. Last week, during the Easter Sunday sermon, I mentioned the scene from The Princess Bride where our hero Wesley was a prisoner in Count Rugen's torture chamber. One of the devices in the torture chamber is a machine that sucks the life out of its victims. He starts by sucking 1 year out of the life of our hero. And then he sucks a little bit more of the life away, and a little bit more, and a little bit more. And in the end, Count Rugen leaves our hero Wesley mostly dead. But if you remember last week, mostly dead is slightly alive. Well, you may not be the hero in The Princess Bride, but chances are that you've had events and experiences in life that have sucked the life out of you. Today, during our time together, we are going to be going back to our series on the 23rd Psalm. We're going to be looking at how life has this way of draining our desires. But God wants to restore our soul. God wants to move and work and restore in us that energy, that creativity, that desire to live that reflects His glory to the world around us. So far in our study of the 23rd Psalm, we've looked at God's answer to anxiety. We live a life full of fear and worry, but God in His relationship with us and our relationship with God has this promise that because the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. A couple weeks ago, we looked at God's answer to activity. We live very busy lives, and sometimes we're too busy. And that's why God works in green meadows and peaceful streams to renew and restore us. Well, today, during our time together, we're going to be looking at God's answer to apathy. Do you know what apathy is? It's when you get to the point in life that you just don't care anymore. Apathy is defined as a lack of feeling or emotion, a lack of interest or concern. Our word apathy comes from the Greek word pathos, which means passion or emotion. Apathy is the lack of passion or emotion. Another way of saying it is that we're living lives just going through the motions, trying to get from point A to point B without energy, without excitement, without passion, and without purpose. That's not what God wants from us. God wants to speak deep into our heart of hearts. God wants to speak into our soul of souls. He wants to restore that, renew that, recreate that in us so that we reflect His glory to the world around us. Today, our text will be looking at Psalm 23:3. I'm going to put up three different versions, and I want us to read through these together. Psalm 23:3 from the New Living Translation puts it this way. He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to His name. The New American Standard says this, that He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. And the message makes it a little interesting. But listen, true to your word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Now, usually I like the way the New Living Translation translates the text, but this is one of those instances, one of those situations where I feel like the New Living Translation falls short of the original meaning of the text. He renews my strength. Just doesn't have the same power or purpose or passion as He restores my soul. Now, before we begin breaking down the Bible to see what timeless truths we can learn from our time together today, I want to take a moment and I want to define this term. I want to look at the word soul. Sometimes we look at the word soul in the terms of the trichotomy of human existence. This school of thought thought says that we as human beings exist in three ways at the same time. We exist in body, soul, and spirit. Some theologians believe that this is another way of expressing the truth that we as humans are created in the image of God. We serve a triune God that is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So since we are created in the image of a triune God, we exist in body, soul, and spirit. Well, there, that's your theological lesson for today. And that's an interesting discussion to have, but it's not one that I want to get into this morning. What I want to get into here is what David meant when he uses this phrase, he restores my soul. The word soul here means life or spirit. It's not referring to that part of us that will live on for eternity. It's referring to that part that motivates us today to live our life with energy, passion, and excitement. It's really the sum of all we are and the sum of who we are. It's mental, it's emotional, it's relational, and most of all, it's spiritual. The concept behind this phrase is God restores our desire to live. Jesus spoke of a river of life that flows from within a person. Jesus said that he had come to give us life and that life would be more abundant. That's what David wants to convey with this phrase. The Lord restores my soul. Listen to this quote I found while studying for this passage. The reference is not to the soul as wandering or backsliding from God, but to the life or spirit as exhausted, wearied, troubled, anxious, worn down with care and toil. The heart thus exhausted, he reanimates it. He brings it back to vigor. He encourages it. It excites to new effort, fills it with new joy. Let me give you an illustration that illustrates this point. One of my favorite movies is It's a Wonderful Life. You know the story. It traces the life of George Bailey from the moment he saves his brother from the frozen pond until he realizes that he really has lived a wonderful life. Throughout the movie, we see his sacrifices, we see his service, we see his dreams, his ambitions, but most of all, we see his discouragement and we see his despair. In his state of despair and his state of discouragement, George Bailey gets the idea that life would have been better for everyone else around him if he had never been born. Did you ever think that? Did you ever feel that? That life would be better if you've never been born? Well, George Bailey in the movie It's a Wonderful Life was given a great gift. He was given the opportunity to see what life would have been like if he had never been born. His little brother Harry, when he fell through the ice, he would have died. The druggist, Mr. Gower, would have gone to prison for poisoning a customer. Bedford Falls would have been Pottersville, and Mary became an old maid. After just seeing what life would have been like if he had never been born, George Bailey realizes that he really, truly lived a wonderful life. And on the bridge, he prays this prayer, I want to live again. I want to live again. I want to live again. Dear God, please let me live again. Look, this is what David means by this phrase. He restores my soul. He puts in us that desire to live again, that desire to live a life of passion, a life of purpose, a life of meaning. That's what David means here. It's not just existing. It's really, truly living. As we look at God's answer for apathy, let's take a few moments to look at what causes apathy in our lives. What is it about life that drains us of our energy and our excitement? What aspects of life drain our desire and our determination? What leaves us feeling the blahs and the blues? What is it that sucks the life from our souls? In considering these questions, I asked several people this week to give me a list of the things in life that make them feel lifeless and useless. Their responses were very interesting. Here's a list of some of what people had to say. So what is it that sucks the life out of you? What leaves you feeling lifeless and useless? One person answered with the word monotony. Doing the same things over and over and over again. Monotony is defined as the lack of variety, tedious, sameness, sameness of tone or sound. Now, imagine what life would be like if there was just one kind of music. Okay, let's see, I wrote down even a little bit more. Not just only one kind of music, but only one note of music. So rather than a grand symphony, we would have a plink, plink, pluck, pluck. One note, one sound, one instrument. It wouldn't be very much fun to listen to. On a funny note, though, this week I saw a meme that's been making its way around Facebook. The meme said, "Who knew that one of the hardest parts of being an adult is deciding what to have for dinner every night for the rest of your life?" There's something about monotony that just drains the energy from our life. I asked another person this week, "What is it about life that leaves you feeling lifeless and useless?" Their answer, unmet expectations. Another thing that increases the sourness of our souls is unmet expectations. Now, they might be unrealistic expectations or uncommunicated expectations. Either way, when things don't go our way, the way that we have planned them or dreamed them or desired for them to be, sometimes our hearts grow hard and our souls grow sour. There is something about being human that makes us think that life ought to always be like we think life ought to always be. Did you get that? As being a human, we think that life always ought to be like we think life ought to be. We get this picture in our mind of what the perfect life would look like. Well-behaved kids with perfect smiles, well-paying jobs with little stress, and what little stress there is, we get to leave at the office at the end of the days. Sunshine, happy days, and that's not always how it is. As a matter of fact, that's rarely how it is. Unmet expectations drain the life from us. I was talking to one person this week over Messenger, and I asked them, "What is it about life that drains the energy from your life?" And their answer surprised me. They said, "Politics." One of the things that saps our souls of life today, in life in today's world, is politics. Politics have always been a dog-eat-dog world, but today it's a 24/7, 365 dog-eat-dog world. We never get a break. As soon as one political cycle ends, another election cycle begins, and it just repeats itself time after time after time. The word politics is an interesting word. You know what the prefix poly means. It means many or several, a lot. And you know what a tick is. It's a blood-sucking insect. So what is politics? A lot of blood-sucking insects. Seems to be pretty appropriate to me. All right. What else creates in us this feelings of uselessness and lifelessness? I asked one person this week, and their answer was family tensions. When I asked this person, what is it that leaves them feeling drained at the end of the day, they said family tensions. Several people made this conversation or response on our Facebook group page. They took this and they looked at this, that stress in home impacts everyone in the home. Stress at work, if you can even go to work, creates stress at home. Stress at home changes the way that we relate to each other. There is more complaining, more criticizing, less patience, and more problems. The family tensions drain people of energy and excitement in their life. Another person said that they were afraid for the future. This showed up in several different ways and several different responses. Worry, concern, anxiety, the fear of the unknown, the fear of the future. And honestly, just a quick look at the world around us leaves us feeling this way. The pandemic, uncertain job situations, uncertain financial situations, being isolated and separated from the ones we love. And then there are the spiritual aspects of life that leave us feeling blah and battling the blues. Every one of us in one way or another deal with the issues of sin, guilt, shame. A lot of us bear in our lives these consequences of destructive decisions that we've made throughout the course of our life. A lot of us are battling on a daily basis with addictions. Each of these things, in and of themselves, are something through grace, strength, and prayer that we can handle. What happens, though, is very rarely do we have to face one of these all by themselves. Usually life is a combination of one, two, or three of these things hitting us all at once, and it leaves feeling like we've been battered, broken, and bruised. When I was in junior high and high school, our youth group made an annual trip to Astroworld. That's the big amusement park in Houston. We all loved the roller coasters, the riverboat rides. However, my favorite ride was the bumper cars. You remember the bumper cars? Let me tell you this. The bumper cars are great as long as you're the one that gets to do the bumping. When you're the one that's being bumped, not so much. Imagine you're riding in the bumper cars and you're stuck out in the middle of the ring, and all of a sudden you look around and everybody's got their eye on you. They turn and they accelerate, wham, 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 wham. Sometimes that's what it feels like in life. We can deal with one thing, maybe even deal with two things, but we get hit, hit, hit again and again, and it leaves us feeling lifeless and useless. It leaves us feeling broken and battered. Let me tell you, that's not the way that God wants you to live your life. God has an answer for apathy. And David brings it up here in Psalm 23. He restores my soul. He renews my strength. He restores my soul. Now, there are two ways that God works in our lives to restore our souls. One, He works directly through the cross of Christ and all that the resurrection has accomplished in our lives. And number two, He works indirectly through the wonder of creation. So He works through the cross of Christ and the wonder of creation. Let's look at this. When God wants to move in your life, when God wants to restore your soul, we start here with looking at what Jesus Christ did on the cross. Last week was Easter Sunday, the high and holy day on the Christian calendar. It's even higher than the opening day of baseball season and the opening day of trout season. This is it, the number one day, Easter Sunday, the day that we mark the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. As a Christian musician, Larry Norman, sang, they nailed him to the cross and they laid him in the ground. They should have known you can't keep a good man down. During Easter, we focus on the crucifixion and the resurrection as we should. But something else happened during that time that symbolized a new relationship between God and man because of what Jesus Christ has done. If you read the story, it's added in there that the temple, the curtain in the temple, was torn in two from top to bottom. This is symbolizing that God is opening up a new way for us to relate for Him, a new way for us to walk in relationship with Him because of what Jesus Christ has done. So because of this, there are several things that God uses to restore our soul through our relationship to Him through Jesus Christ. The first one is the act of worship. When we worship, we get our eyes off of ourselves, we get our eyes on God, we get a glimpse of His glory, His grace, His majesty, His awesomeness, His wonder. Do you remember Robert's rules of reality? Rule number one and rule number two. Rule number one says this, there is a God. Rule number two says, you are not Him and neither am I. When we worship, we get a glimpse of God as we see Him like the Isaiah the prophet in Isaiah 6 saw Him, high and lifted up, surrounded by His majesty and His glory. And we respond with the words of the great hymn of the Christian faith, then sings my soul, my Savior God to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Worship restores our soul. As we worship, we also experience God's grace and forgiveness. We realize that as God is high and God is holy and God is lifted up, what a privilege it is just to come before Him. And we come before Him because He said we could. We receive His grace. We find His forgiveness. Our spirit is strengthened. Our souls are restored because of God's grace and forgiveness. Then God also begins to work in our life indirectly through the wonders of creation. Not only does God work in our hearts and souls through what Jesus Christ has done on the cross, He also works indirectly through the world around us. Yes, we live in a sinful, fallen world. Yes, we live in a world that's marked by sorrow and selfishness. But we also live in a world that reveals the glory of God to anyone who will take the time to look for it. So, how does God restore our soul? He restores our soul through nature. Nature was one of the top answers when asked what restores our soul. People talked about how hiking through the hills, a day at the beach, just even seeing the sunshine restores their soul. In Psalm 19, verses 1 through 4, Scripture records this. The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The skies display His craftsmanship. Day after day they continue to speak. Night after night they make Him known. They speak without sound or word. Their voice is never heard, yet their message has gone throughout the earth and their words to all the world. God has made a home in the heavens for the sun. The heavens declare the glory of God. The mountains, the seas, the great plains of the Midwest. God has put evidence all around us for His existence. God has put beauty in nature to restore our souls. The Apostle Paul in the book of Romans wrote this, "For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and the sky. Through everything that God made, they can clearly see His invisible qualities, His eternal power, and His divine nature, so they have no excuse for not knowing God." God reveals Himself through nature, and it restores our souls as we experience this. Another way that God works indirectly through the wonder of creation is the ability to work and to do physical activity. Now, if you read the story of the Bible, at first work was a blessing. Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, God gave them the opportunity to care for it. And then through the fall, it became a burden. But when work is done right, work can be a blessing again. God restores our souls as we work. This is part of what it means to be created in the image of God. God worked and God rested. God said, "This is the pattern I want for you. I want you to work and I want you to rest." And as we do that, God restores our soul. One day when I was a kid growing up in South Texas, we had a major thunderstorm rip through the area. Fierce winds, heavy rains, thunder, lightning, dark clouds. The storm seemed to last forever. I'm only sure it was only an hour or so. But by the time the storm had passed, our yard was a mess. Broken limbs everywhere. Magnolia leaves everywhere. And my dad looked at me and he said, "Son, it's time to get to work." We had to clean up the yard. And by the end of the day, I was exhausted. I looked at my dad and I said, "Dad, I'm tired." And I will never forget my dad's response to that. My dad said, "Yeah, but it's a good tired." And it was. God put within us this desire to work. And even if it comes through broken limbs and magnolia trees, God restores our soul. Another way of God uses to restore our soul, and I just threw this in here for a few of you that might appreciate it, is the wonder of two wheels. There's an old saying among motorcyclists that four wheels move the body, two wheels move the soul, and it's true. And so I put up a picture here of Cedric having his soul restored as we got to enjoy the wonder of two wheels together. All right, it's time to start bringing this to a close. Let's wrap up our time together. God wants to restore your soul. He wants to speak life into your heart. He wants to speak life into your soul. Life has a way of tearing us down. God wants to build us up. When our kids were small, one of my favorite toys to play with them were building blocks. We'd love to get out the building blocks and we'd build something, we'd knock it down. We'd build something else, we'd knock it down. It was always so much fun to build something up, to knock it down, and to build something else in its place. Now, as much fun as that was, imagine that we built something up and it just got knocked down and just stayed there on the ground. Each of those building blocks just lying there. Listen, life has a way of doing that to each one of us. There is something in our life that knocks us down, something in our life that leaves us lying there feeling hopeless and helpless. God does not want us to live that way. God wants us to take these words that David wrote. He restores my soul. And not just read them. God wants us to experience them. God wants to put in us that energy, that excitement, that passion for life, the thing that speaks within us, that shows to the world around us that God is a part of our life and reflects the glory of God to the world around us. This morning, as we wrap up our time together, I just want you to close your eyes. I want you to bow your head, and I want you to open your heart for just a moment. What are the things in your heart right now, the things in your life right now, that are making you feel hopeless, helpless, lifeless, useless? Uncertain job situation, family tension, monotony, political reality all around us. What is it that's draining the life from your soul? What I want you to do is I just want you to reach out and give those things to God, whatever they are. And as you give those things to God, I want you to see that God is giving you your soul through worship, through the Word, through the experiences that God has given us in nature, through the opportunities that God has given us to work and to be renewed and to be restored. So as you give those burdens, would you receive God's blessing? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, for our soul. I love watching these TV shows where something is broken and ruined and rusty and people give up hope. And then they put it in the hands of somebody that knows what they're doing and it comes back bright and beautiful. Lord, our souls have been broken and have been battered. And for some people, they feel rusty and ruined. Life has left us in a place, Lord, where we just don't feel much like living. Father, I pray that you would restore their souls. I pray that you would put in them the desire to live and to live for you and to live for something of meaning and value. Father, I pray for those that are feeling helpless and hopeless. I pray that you would speak life to them today. Lord, thank you so much that you restore our soul. And I pray, like George Bailey prayed on that bridge, that we would say, "Dear God, I want to live again." And out of that, you would bring life to your people. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise. My song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes. I'll lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When I cannot see you, with my eyes, let faith arise to you. When I cannot feel you with my mind, let faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, you shine with glory, Lord of life. I feel alive with you. In your presence now I come alive, I am alive with you. There is strength when I say, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
Joy of the Lord.
The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When sorrow comes my way, you are the shield around me. Always you remain like courage in the fight. I hear you call my name, Jesus, I am coming. Walking on the ways, reaching for your light. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I'll dance, in the shadows I'll sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength.